Hi, thank you for being so patient. Thank you for being so patient. I know you're, here's the great thing. You're looking at this screen here. Oh, hello, friend. You're looking at this screen here, and you're like, I'm having trouble seeing what's up there. You're not alone. I just wanted to warn you, you do not have some sort of ocular degeneration. My slides will have to be put up at some other point. Right now, just think of this as sort of artwork that goes between my lyrical voice that comes out. So, my name's Jason Scott. How many people have seen talks by me before? Nice number. All right, the rest of you, you made a mistake. So, name of this talk is, did you want to do the, here, just
say. You're good. This is Jason Scott, Text Files.
So. So this is the DeCSS case. This is, I'm going to describe it, but I just wanted you to see this pile of documents. These are all the documents related to a court case. This would be all the testimony that was entered in across the six-day trial. This would be the fuck you. This would be the, no, seriously, fuck you. This would be the please, are you sure you say fuck you, to which this was the fuck you. So that's legal terminology. I just wanted to make sure you knew about it. I'm a veteran of talking, and so I'm really not one to buy into a lot of the stay up in front. And anyway, you guys have been enjoying an ironic Big Brother presentation by Snowden, so there's really no reason for me to do the same thing, so I hope you all don't mind that things are a little more interactive than they need to be. It's been 2 years since my last talk, so yay. So, Hollywood has a secret. Hollywood has a secret, and here's the secret, okay? If you take a image of a guy or girl, and then you show a picture of the opposite sex, and then you switch back to the first one, the audience will immediately decide that that person lusts, is watching, or is otherwise in the same physical space as the other person. In other words, the pictures sit quietly, and we do all the work. And the reason why is because we're human beings, and when you see something disappear into a rock, you know it's probably going to come out again. And when you see it the other side, you go, oh, it's out again. I'm going to eat it. And so we're kind of wired this way. We draw conclusions. We put things aside. That's what we do. And Hollywood, long ago, discovered that by putting these images together and hosting them somewhere, they could pull people out of their otherwise wretched and terrible lives and make them feel like they were someplace else. And over time, they refined that, but I often did it by giving you the same picture of the guy, looking at the picture of the girl, looking back at the picture of the guy. They quickly refined it to a picture of a car chasing after another car, in which the guy in the front car was someone you liked and someone behind it was someone you didn't like. We have other stories too, not many, but this is what the secret was. The secret was the product inside is not that special. But if you're the only game in town and you work hard to make yourself the only game in town, then that product is the product. And it's fantastic, and people will write film criticism about it, and everyone will be happy. So this is about a court case, and the court case is called technically Universal versus Ramirez, but many people call it the DeCSS case. That looks terrible. How ironic that something about visual data being unencrypted looks so terrible, thwarted by HDMI. I like that. I like that. I like the irony. I'm going to go with the irony. Going to go with irony. So this is about a court case, but it's not about a court case. Because court cases are boring. Court cases aren't interesting unless you're in them. And what you really want to do is you want to look at what happened in a court case, and then you want to figure out what can you learn from it? What do we learn for it? Or we'll just keep recycling the same problems, like we recycle the same talks, like we recycle the same movies. So let's try to learn something new from this crazy dumb thing. One day I got a phone call, and I got a phone call, it was basically Emmanuel Goldstein, who for the purposes of this talk we'll call Eric Corley, and who wanted me to talk with the EFF because the EFF had a storage unit, and the storage unit was full of old EFF stuff. and they had hit the term limit. It'd been like 10 years that this stuff had been sitting in there, and they said, we want to get rid of it. And they contacted the people who were in some of the cases to go, what do we do with the old junk from your case? In this case, it was for the DeCSS case, and Eric Corley had been involved in that, and he said basically, you should give it to Jason Scott, and contacted me. And I said, fantastic. And I waited eagerly by my mailbox for it. 5 months later, while I was on my way on a vacation trip, a truck pulled up with a lot of boxes, and I was leaving in 2 hours. Desperate, as you can see, it's winter, my brother and I stacked it up and put plastic over it to protect it from the wind. And I also knew I didn't really have much place for this. I didn't have much space in my shipping container. Yes, I have a shipping container. And so I did the best thing to do, which was put it out on the internet with violins playing, going, this is history. Look where history is very cold. And waited eagerly for somebody to go, oh, history, we'll give you a warm cup of coffee and a little mug and let you sit by the fire. Inside, I printed some pictures. What you're looking at here is some hash and some encrypted files printed out for pages and pages. This is IRC discussions about DVDs printed by the ream. There were 75 boxes of material sealed up with obscure markings outside, only some of which caused me to twitch, with names like defendant and plaintiff's complaint and injunction. And inside, of course, was this whole thing about, you know, history. And I always love these little moments, like this little transcription from the thing where the guy has to spell what Google is. You know, do you go to any besides Hotbot? Yeah, actually, I went to Google, G-O-O-G-L-E. So I knew this was, like, weirdly historical and strange. And things like, I don't know, hard clipping a floppy disk to a piece of paper as a way to indicate the work had been done. Anyway, it was good to have this sort of historical data, and I collect a lot of historical data, and I thought that was kind of interesting, right? Well, it was the Potters, Heidi and Bruce, who stepped forward and said, we'll take it. And I drove a truck of 75 boxes down to their storage area, actually their garage, and loaded them up, barely having cracked one. But they took it, so God bless them. They took them and saved them. And that's where it ends, right? That's where it ends. This thing that was lonely found a home somewhere in the Washington, D.C. area and was soon to live an endless nothing life, once again stored away in the darkness of history and forgotten. But no. What it was, in fact, was something like this. So this is a quote from Isaac Newton. Isaac Newton, you know, he was a pretty intense dude. This was a guy who invented calculus to win a bet, right? When he was 27. That's the source of that whole "we got a badass here" quote when he talks about it. Because he's talking about the fact that to win a bet, he invents calculus to prove what he's saying. And you're reading, you're not going to get this right off. Some of you will, and God bless you. But are not gross bodies and light controvertible into one another, and may not bodies receive much of their activity from the particles of light which enter into their composition? This is the beginning of the nuclear bomb. This is when human beings start figuring out that shit can blow up really fast, faster than we expect. And if we trigger off things, we will explode. It took a few years from 1706. But he was sitting around. I'll bet you he invented direct messaging, too. I'm just going to tell you that now. Many of you might know about the 2600 case, the DeCSS case, the DVD case, Universal et al. Versus Ramirez et al. It all has different names. Some of you may remember it with the snap-trap memory of some geek, or some of you might actually be completely unsure what it is other than it was bad. You may not even know what the verdict was. I'm not going to poll why I do that to you. But sitting on 2600 are the collections of PDFs of all the official stuff. In other words, the PDF version of this material. It's all sitting up there. So if you're the kind of person who wants to read through it line by line, knock yourself out. Knock out everyone around you. Read it home on the way to work while driving. Just do it. Have fun. All right, so basically, you know, you have these wonderful legal terms like appellate reply brief and so on, and I'll go into what the case was, but, you know, that's what it sits right now, a bunch of PDFs of the officially released things, right? Or you can go onto Wikipedia and read kind of their description of what this case was, and, you know, so basically here's what happened, right? There's this thing called the DVD spec, right, which was created to allow digital video discs, which were a form of digital entertainment. They were plastic pieces of discs. I have to say this because some of you are young. And they basically allowed you to store a certain amount of material on them in a digital form and allow a relatively simple player at the time to be able to not just play it, but be able to read menus from it, have subtitles, do a bunch of different video things. And in theory, the clarity was unbelievable and heretofore unseen on Earth. And cheap to produce over time. Well, it depended on a protection scheme of some sort. Mysterious and wonderful. Some sort of black box that sat inside of a chip and made it better, unless you were bad, and then it made it worse. And that's what it did. And somebody came up with a way to read it regardless of that quote-unquote protection. The reason given was, hey, there's no good DVD players for Linux. So you can't play DVDs on Linux, let's fix that. And so over the course of time, this thing came out and a utility was created by a young gentleman, Mr. Johansson, who basically allowed you to do it. It was called the DeCSS utility because this was the content scrambling system, fantastic name, which enabled you to basically unread. Isn't that great? There it is. It's a little blurry, but there it is. This is the terrible thing. You run it and combined with other things, it allows you to read a DVD and not worry about the content scrambling system. The program is very small and it was linked everywhere. And what ended up happening was people put it everywhere because it was amazing and weird and interesting. I don't know how many of them understood it, but it went out there and it went everywhere. And so, as they say, the movie studio sued. And they sued a few people for it. And that was celebrated. As, oh my God, we've pissed them off. And they sued a bunch of people, citing the newly minted, you know, Digital Millennium Copyright Act, 1998, which enabled a whole variety of things to happen. And this code was everywhere, hosted everywhere, including at 2600 magazine. So the movie studios sued a bunch of people, including Eric Corley himself and later his magazine, 2600, for having this. They sought injunctive relief. They wanted many thousands of dollars. And of course, they wanted him permanently banned from ever distributing this. So he took it down as per the request and instead replaced it with a list of mirrors. That's our manual. Just kicks you in the balls while being let out of the club. And so it ended up being linked, and they sued him over that. They said, you can't even link to a thing that does something bad, which was a very interesting innovation legally. And so, you know, when you have a court case like that, of course, it's got the geeks versus the old school versus everything else. It was a 6-day trial after months of preparation, and it was found to be not in 2600's favor. The other defendants all settled. 2600 fought on, as they are wont to do, and they lost. So they appealed, and in a grand decision, they also agreed. So the case was a loss. It was a blow against free speech in some definitions. It was definitely a blow against 2600. Luckily, there were no monetary damages applied. But the judge in it, Judge Kaplan, in a 80-plus page ruling, which is in there, says basically, no, we have to maintain what the movies are, because the movies are very special. And we don't want people to stop getting movies about a guy looking at a girl. Now, the whole thing about copyright, I love talking about that debate. Here's an 1880 Declaration of Copyright on corn harvesters. And a warning against the people who are pirating corn harvesters. Don't do it. Only get the good ones. You'll be liable for damages if you make, sell, or use infringing machines that make corn. So we've been angry a long time where somebody goes, blah, don't steal my shit. I have a thing on it that says no. We've been doing this a long time, right? So the Digital Millennium Copyright Act was simply an extension of that idea. It said, okay, now there's all these different things we're going to do that are digital. So that's weird. Wow, you have the ability to make something make infinite copies of itself. Oh, that breaks something. You also have the ability for it to be perfect every time. You have the ability for it to be passed everywhere simply. Well, here's a bunch of laws saying that's all kind of bad. And it's been improved upon over time. You know, in this country, if you videotape a movie, or let's say you use a digital camera, but let's go with videotape, I like that better. Let's say you take in an RCA Panasonic VHS camera, and you walk in and you record The Expendables 3, and for some reason, the gendarmes in their little fucking red vests walk up and grab you. How many years are you liable for? 5. You get off easy. Yeah, 5. Record a movie, 5 years of jail. $250,000 fine. That's very important to this country. We are a country where if you record something off a screen, you are liable for 5 years of prison, $250,000. This must be really friggin' important. This must be the golden child. It's because of the Motion Picture Association of America. They have a perfect right to exist, and what they do and they get involved in makes sense. What they are is all of the motion picture and Hollywood firms kind of don't like each other. They really kind of don't, but they all agree they have things they agree upon that need to be enforced and looked at and lobbied for. But the problem is that they never want to sit in each other's goddamn office. So why not have an office that they all agree that they'll listen to? And that's the Motion Picture Association of America. They created the rating system, for instance. They were the ones who certify different kinds of sound. They're the ones that dictate what the size of a screen is. They involve themselves in all sorts of intercompany processes in motion pictures. But they also deal in enforcement. And they've gone a little more than enforcement. They've actually worked into going, wow, this current society is not ready to protect our stuff to the level we want. What can we do to warp reality to our needs? Do I sound angry? I'm not really angry. It's just more like, oh man. You know, like when you like see a cat or a deer like jump out of one car and get hit by another and you're like, oh man. It's kind of that like sad, withering disappointment in the whole process, kind of. Just kind of a sadness, right? I mean, this is a city where we just killed somebody because you sold the wrong cigarettes. I mean, you gotta keep perspective, but there's this thing going on. And so, you know, they have all these things that they've put up now, and they speak the crazy language. You can click, but you can't hide. Look out. And that should be the end of it. Hooray, we do not steal anything anymore. That's it. That's how it goes. Can I get a round of applause for the end of infringement? Wow, that's fantastic. That's a pretty good half-hearted sarcastic clap, but I'm telling you, when you're doing sarcasm and you want to make everyone in the room feel uncomfortable, you got to whoop it up, okay? Germany has to kick someone's ass, and you're like, yeah! So that's just so in the future, when you get sarcastic clap, please do that. Sarcastic claps are your most powerful weapon in today's society. No, it's not the end. Of course not. There's people like me. Now, so, Okay. All right. You don't need anything? Do you need a water? Do you want a water? No, okay. So I'm this dude, I get old things. I have textfiles.com, I've made documentaries, I speak about history, I look up stuff. I kind of buffer the area between people who are like, what do I do with all these eggs? And people going, what do I do with all these egg cartons? And saying, oh, you two gotta meet. And later, oh, eggs and egg cartons. And I'm just like, I don't need credit, I don't need my name on the cartons. I'm just so glad those eggs found their cartons. And I do that all the time. Someone's hard drive comes to me, makes a whole bunch of difference in the world. Talk to people who were like, I don't know where to host this. I only have, it's 1 gigabyte of data. I'm like, I'll handle it. I'll take it, it's okay. So I walk around and I'm this weird angel of death that sits around at the end of things. And I say, oh, wow, no one cares anymore. So it was with that reputation that I was given these old files that you might recall were stored away, again, having lived 10 years inside of a box, unlooked at, unloved, forgotten, and the DeCSS case, which you are now an expert on, living away. So, let's talk about America. America! So here's the great thing about America. So we have a current situation. How many people here have ever been the plaintiff? Okay. How many people here have been the defendant? Not bad, not bad. Same here, defendant. Defendant, whoa, fist bump, defendant. It's not very nice to be the defendant in America right now. Here's why. We've put up a whole variety of system of laws, and the systems of laws work on this theory. You hold a 1,000-pound weight over someone's head, and you show them a picture of your family, and you say, wouldn't it be terrible if this weight fell on you and your family never saw you again? For the mere price of $500, sign this paper, sit over here, don't make us have an actual court case, you will not get the 1,000-pound weight. And then people see the turnover and they go, the system works. System doesn't work, buddies. Doesn't work at all. We have places where people are just heralded in and their fake pro bono lawyer says, just take the plea, and they walk away. And so it's like, why get hit by a truck when you could get hit by a golf cart that drags you for the rest of your life? And anybody here who's a defendant, especially a defendant who's not defending themselves against something that is the course of right, makes the discovery, as Emmanuel did. You know, there's problems with the case, okay? There's problems with the DeCSS case. First of all, I'm sure he's going to get angry when he reads this somewhere, but the lawyer for the defense was kind of a dick. Kind of a dick. He is badgering witnesses. He is arguing with the judge. There are cases that we have. I have tapes of the actual, you know, it's one thing to have a deposition where you can see it says, the lawyer says, no, sir, I want to know this, in fact. Could you please tell us? And then the other lawyer going, objection, this is badgering. And to hear the tape where he's like, and what about this, and this, and this, in that tone of voice? What kind of case is that going to go for you? So not a great lawyer. Not a great lawyer for this case. I'm sure he's wonderful for other cases, but this wasn't a great case. And so when you are in that situation, Eric found himself what we often find ourselves in, which is that the legal system is like the world's scariest combine harvester, a shredder, and it's the worst kind of shredder. Have you guys all seen the video of the thing that shreds a tree in 2 seconds? Yeah, look at that. We're a great country. All of you know this cultural touchstone. Basically, it starts with a tree and goes, wham, like that tree's gone. Environmentalists love it. Well, that maybe that's not so bad. I mean, if somebody threw you into that and said, sorry, man, and just went, wham, you could handle it. But what happens if the combine harvester grabs your leg? And you're like, oh, what's wrong with me? Oh, man. Hey, everybody, combine harvester, you know. And they're like, oh, no, there's no off switch. It just goes. And you're like, what? And like, yeah, no, it's going to keep going. You're like, what? What? No, it's like starting to hurt, buddy. You got to, no. It will go slowly for between 1 and 3 years and shred you to pieces. Your counteroffer is that you can cut off your leg or something else. I have seen what the system does to somebody who's under that 1,000-pound weight. I've lost friends to that. So I know that situation exists. So I can forgive Eric for just wanting this terrible thing out of his life until they decided there was no particular thing against him. He was, he was worried. He was sitting there going, maybe I'm going to be ordered to get $250,000 for this. You know, he didn't know. He lived under that, and it just eats your guts inside. I was sued for $120,000 for printing an IP address. would have cost me a lot. And I had a really nice guy who used to work for the company who sued me and said, oh, fuck those guys, I'll pay all your legal bills. That guy threw $20,000 into a fire for me, which tells you he must have been really angry. I like that guy. He had a concealed carry and an Uzi. Anyway, so concealed carry plus Uzi equals party. Anyway, so yeah, you know, taking the whole, you know, way you look at the world, right? I mean, there is something to be said for like going the extra distance, putting yourself out a little bit and trying to do it. And that's what I think is more important than the particular court case is standing up for what you believe in. I know this may sound like empty words, but they're not. Because there's always that moment. There's that moment in that meeting. There's that moment in your life. There's that moment in a court case where someone says, you know, here's the easy way out. Just cut the leg off. Just cut the leg off. The 1,000-pound weight will never fall. And you know what? Fuck the weight. And that's a decision you make with your family and you. And some of you will have to make which decision you want. But it might even be something as simple as, do we make this data exportable or do we lock it down? Do we, you know, share what we're learning or do we hide it? Do we take advantage of this? Do we put it away? Do you, as an analyst, watch some crazy shit go by the transom at your job? And do you go to Hawaii and then to Russia, a natural jump? So there's this weird, weird way the world is working right now that we have this situation, right? So let's go back to the bomb. let's go back to this thing. So here's this whole piece of documents. They were discarded. They were thrown away. And by thrown away, they were thrown into me. All right? And there's 75 boxes, and that could have been the end of it. Here they are. So what we did was, at ShmooCon this year, we took the boxes and we put them out. And ShmooCon, love those guys, ShmooCon.com, they set up all the boxes and the videotapes and set up scanning stations. And we had volunteers during this show sit down and scan. We didn't get a lot. We got a lot, but we didn't get a ton. We didn't get all of it. We had people sitting down and looking for quote-unquote juicy stuff, quote-unquote interesting stuff. I didn't tell them what to scan. This looks interesting. Scan it. Scan it, scan it. Why not? We scanned about 8,000 pages in one weekend. And we had the boxes out. People could try to be their own quasi Columbo and look it up. You know, it was kind of nice. Actually, it was very nice. And, I mean, there was even, you know, like weird stories on the side of these things and what did this mean and so on. Some of it's redundant. There'll be four or five copies of the same thing in four boxes, thank God. But, you know, they were kind of interesting. This is by far my favorite picture, and here's why. Dad, daughter. They're scanning side by side, and she's asking what the legal terms mean, and he's telling her. And she just wants to know what the case means. She's like, oh, he's saying that there's going to be extra money he has to spend if he goes this way. And she's like, and what's this part? And why are they doing this? And they just sat there and had a little law lesson between the two of them for like 2 hours. In the middle of a con they paid friggin' money for that's not easy to get into. That's amazing. That's the kind of family get-together I think we all need to have, isn't it? Just sit around reading legal cases and answering them to your kids. Man, Hollywood. So, you know, I mean, Hollywood is an example of a very entrenched industry, okay? And it's very fun within a certain range to beat up Hollywood and punch them in the face, and isn't that fun and whatever else. You know, they have elements of, you know, I'm not gonna say they're organized crime-y. You know, it's like a little touch of the mafia to them. But the reason why is because they have a very strong control over a certain number of things, and they execute very, very strong control over it, and we notice it. It's in the open. That's creepy. Like when it turned out that like Pixar, creator of Up, were like involved in like wage fixing, you're like, oh man. But you didn't see that day to day with Pixar. You weren't like, wow, those guys, the Wall-E people. But oh well, everyone's corrupt, Hollywood most of all. So inside of this thing was evidence that was, you know, not entered into the case. So there's all sorts of interesting things in here, and the fact is that's what's kind of fun, because, you know, when you go through trash, you know, we really got out of the trashing aspect when they finally figured out how to lock down the central office trash barrels and they also figured out how to shred really well. When cross-cutting came, there are a lot of old-school hackers who were like, oh, man. There's a lot of, you know, good old-school New York taggers who were like, God damn it. You know, the thing where they can clean a train car in, like, 2 minutes. Oh, man. So the cross-cutting shredder was not your buddy. These aren't shredded. And, you know, what's interesting is that they kind of tell a different narrative of the whole thing that I think is interesting in a boring sort of way in terms of here's all of these things that was the other side. I don't think any of it will surprise you. It might surprise you that it's written down somewhere. But it's more a case of, like, what I want you to walk away from is a realization that this is always happening. That this is happening in Nokia and Microsoft and the NSA and your local bodega and your other friends and everything. People are keeping dual narratives. And sometimes the streams cross, but not often. And entering into the world with that is that's your first line of security, is realizing that the whole game of humanity is fixed. Just so you know. Is that cheery enough? Is that cheery? I was trying to be upbeat about that. I mean, it's fixed. Woo! I said sarcastic. Oh, well, anyway, there we go. Smattering golf clap of sarcasm. I cast a +5 star. So, you know, it's not going to, you know, when you look back at, like, the 2000s and you see this kind of stuff, get ready for piracy.com and everything else, you know, it's kind of interesting. And you have a whole stuff about, like, the great cyber robbery and the whole portrayal of, like, how it's going to be terrible when this all happens. This is all circa 1999, 2000 articles in Variety, and it shouldn't surprise you that if the MPAA wants something in Variety, it's getting into Variety. You know, when Valenti calls for the end to invasion of the copyright snatchers. Jack Valenti. How many people here know who Jack Valenti was? The man's dead, you cowards. Cowardice! That's good, all right. If you can't protect what you own, you don't own anything. So here's what Jack's job was. Jack's job was to be the clarion call, the messenger of infringement, power, and what needed to be done for our friend, the Hollywood cartel. And he was good at it. So what I like here, this is something that's very important. Here's, if you can't protect what's yours, you own nothing. And the other one is, if you can't protect what you own, you don't own anything. These are two different cases. This one went to Congress. This one goes to the people. And I just thought it was interesting that they thought that's a better way to phrase it for the people. You own nothing. And then the other one is the more appropriate, right? You don't own anything. Anyway, Jack was always kind of doing this stuff. Here's the quote, that the money quote, right? The money quote. Answering a question and responding to another lobbyist. One of the Japanese lobbyists, Mr. Ferris, had said that the VCR, I know I'm reading off, I'm breaking that rule, but fuck it. If I'm saying something wrong, forgive me. He said the VCR is the greatest friend that the American film producer ever had, and I say to you that the VCR is to the American film producer and the American public as the Boston Strangler is to the woman home alone. This was during a congressional hearing on recording of copyrighted works in 1982 from Jack Valenti, okay? And I'm really sad because in some ways, this is like Rio is to Duran Duran. It's the one everyone knows, and there were so many other great Duran Duran hits. Replace Duran Duran with something else that'll make you sneer. The point is that this was just one mere phrase in a lifetime of lyrical phrasings that were just beyond belief that came out of this guy. And I think it's unfair how we usually portray him. So this is the guy I want to remember. This suave motherfucker. That guy, oh my God. You looked at him and you were like, what do you need, sir? And he would say, you know, we got a business here. Business has got a lot of problems. Maybe you can do something to alleviate that problem. I mean, that's kind of the way I want to remember this guy. I less want to remember him this way, which of course is the scary, screaming eagle of movie freedom. There he is, man. Man, that guy. This is recordings of him from the testimony, by the way. I've put these online. If it was your hope, pro or con, as to whether or not it affected the case, if you want to listen to the lawyer scream at him for 1 hour, it's up there. If you want to hear him just badger this man at 6 in the morning, and he's sick, I mean, he's not faking it, he's pretty friggin' sick that morning. He's got, like, the flu, and he's been basically dragged in, and he's being screamed at the whole time. Well, if you wanted that, it happened. That fixed everything, didn't it? But there he is. You know, he was part of this group. And so part of this narrative was that all these groups were like, how are we going to protect ourselves? And the way that they were like, we're going to protect ourselves is we need to like look at this digital thing. Now, the digital thing has already happened, right? This is all circa 95, 96. It's kind of happened. It's not as big as it could be, but it's kind of happened. And they're like, all right, all right, let's start thinking about digital. How are we going to do digital? Well, we can't just, and what you realize is the brutish way that they go about it, which is, how are we going to do this? Well, are they going to be able to steal it? Make them stop. This was a group that tried, lobbied, and failed to have VCRs not rewind as a copy protection measure. When they started to work on this particular, you know, DVD scheme, they realized that some of the protection scheme would be undone by some models of VCRs, and they were preparing to badger and sue the companies that took them away. They hired some good people, I find. All these different people to work on the content scrambling system. In fact, there's a beautiful document that describes all the different ways one would attack any digital stuff in the future, created by some of the finest minds that they could hire. IBM, Rand Corporation, Apple, who, you know, all were more than happy to describe ways in which copy could be protected. This is all very informative things. These are very well-paid people describing casual hacking versus happenstance versus sophistication, high sophistication, low resource, high sophistication, a whole set of language that they were keeping to themselves until now. The overall scheme is not especially resistant to sophisticated hardware-based hack methods. The low resistance is due to inherently weak cryptography. To place the scheme in perspective, it is a factor of 10 to the 6th minus 10 to the 4th weaker than a scheme based on the data encryption standard. So they were like, maybe you ought to do something about that. And it's not their fault, they claim. There's a lot of toadying back and forth. I love this document. This is trying to portray all the different ways you could approach. And the reason it interests me is because to show how you don't want the content stolen, you want to talk about the peasants. And your problem, of course, is, you know, some peasants have ladders, but most can't swim. But they don't have special clothing. They can't get past the guards. So you have a combination of guards, boiling oil, a moat, a fence, and the peasants, eagerly awaiting to find out when Expendables 4 is coming out. Oh my God, Need for Speed 38 is on its way. Oh my God. No, they dug up the guy. It's amazing. They dug him up and they scanned him. That's crazy, edgy shit. Let's go watch that. And I want to, you know, if you, you know, please remember this, that somebody thought it was okay to refer to the consumer as peasants and to describe as the entire thing as a life or death struggle to protect the castle. Whoever made this because they knew that would fly in the boardroom, right? And then there was like another problem which they didn't really think about, which we should think about in the future. Anyone here ever have an Apex DVD recorder, player? Yeah! Here's the thing about the DVD player. It had an admin testing mode. And the problem with it was you did this, turn it on, do no disk, hit setup, do your shit, press track forward in this situation, and the loopholes menu is displayed. And you can change the region, you can turn off the encryption, you can turn off macrovision, and there's a little thing down here you can't quite see. It says, you should not be here. They sold 500,000 of those. That happened. Because basically, the guys who make this were like, fuck it, we're just going to do this. It makes it easier to work with it. Leaked out. It's also interesting to note that when the DeCSS case happened, they hired a private investigation firm. And the private investigation firm gives a, you know, if you're sitting around in your IRC channel, and the firm was hired, and the firm did amazing amounts of work. Here they are doing a timeline of who came with what piece in DeCSS over the course of the year, all the way down to the name and what part they were and where they were and what part they provided and they figured out that some person's unknown provided some of the information, and so on. But man, we should nail that kid, Mr. You know, Johan's code and the code on slash dot are one and the same. You know, Johan, don't public post, but could he send a private copy? Oh, he released the code. Paul calls him brave. So this is another interesting document. This is a PR firm that was hired to say, now that we're gonna sue the fuck out of this little kid, how do we deal with that? I don't know if you've ever read a PR document before. It is the mask of humanity unmasked. It is the wolf behind the door. You know, there's concern it's gonna cause a PR backlash. It's great language. It's gonna cause a PR backlash. We should be concerned. Retailers will be angry. They'll think that we're no good at what we do. The market for early adopters to the mass market, they're gonna see this and get scared. We have to do something, right? In terms, there's two key sexy stories that could be of interest. The 15, 17-year-old boy, human interest story. Hacking of the DVD encryption, a giant corporate industry screw-up story. The boy is integral to the story. So, despite the fact that he is Norwegian, and while we could desire any focus to be on the Scottish man, the Scott story is dot, dot, dot. It's that kind of just ripping it open and seeing what's there. The backlash, if it happens, is likely to be huge American film giants destroying the boy, and the boy turned into a modern-day genius who didn't realize what he was doing, the war game scenario, a David and Goliath story. Now, this is happening anytime you find yourself on the wrong end of something and you're fighting the big Goliath, by the way. This is happening behind the scenes, so I just want you to be aware of that. They're hiring a place to go, how do we couch this so we look awesome? You know, so the thing is, what I want you to understand, you know, is less that, oh yeah, there's some goofy, juicy stuff about this particular case that didn't make it into the court documents and isn't that. I want you to, like, think about the fact that this happens every time we have this sort of legal thing, and this is what goes on, I know. And we're going to always, always, always keep our eyes open, right? To knowing that this is the situation going on, that we don't just deal in the truth and justice, we deal in narratives, image, and wonder. We deal in telling what we're doing. We deal in making ourselves known to each other, the presentation form versus what logic should tell you. So many geeks go down hard because they say logic, that's what hurt you, was the whole way of saying, well, logic says this should be this way. And it's like, no, a completely feral enforcement system has decided to fuck you hard using every tool, and we're just arming them more. Now, there's always ways around it, of course. There's cute little moves you can do that says opening, breaking this seal constitutes acceptance of the end user license agreement. It's funnier when I don't have to say it, but what are you gonna do? Yeah, there's always gonna be rebellion, and I want that. I think life should be fun. I think we should enjoy ourselves, but also keep in mind what's behind it. That's the real sunset. That's the real happy ending. Don't ever lie in your bed going, well, at least I didn't make a fuss. Okay? Thank you very much for your time. There will be no questions because we don't have the time, but I'll be wandering about in a very rakish hat making myself known. I would love to see you all. This is a very special social time for me to see so many of my friends out there. Thank you, friends.
75? 75 will be small. Okay, now let's see what happens. Nope.
Another window. Okay.
Why? Because I'm mirroring displays, so just go into arrangement and switch them?
Behind the screen.
No, there isn't. What?
Yeah.
Oh, son of a bitch. Okay, can I tell you something? That's not even supposed to be there. Not working. I did. No, we're not. Really? No. Whose brilliant idea was that, and why did I listen? All right, this is ridiculous. You know, it's not like Jerry Springer. You can't just yell things at me. Does anybody know what the deal is, really? I mean, everybody's yelling suggestions.
What I would try is first.
Do you actually know the answer?
I have a Mac.
I have many Macs. Okay. What would you suggest?
I would do two steps. I would turn off mirror displays on the...
Why?
Because this screen and that screen are different sizes. And then in Keynote, you're going to set the presentation to be displayed to the secondary monitor.
Well, hold on. Yeah, see, no.
Okay.
But hold on.
Presenter display?
Yeah, I understand that, but hold on one second. I've never had to do this before. I'm at 1024 by 768 stretched, so let me try not stretched. And let me try this. Okay. Quiet. Present the display. Okay, that was the problem. Okay.
It looks good.
I've
there.
Never had a problem here. This is really annoying. Okay, so I'm going to assume you're wrong and see what happens. Yeah, tell me what I'm doing wrong, Andrew.
You're running a Mac.
I'm running a Mac. By 60 or 75? Okay. Yeah, I know. Oh, son of a bitch. Okay, not what I meant to do. Wrong. Okay, I've done this for 20 years. I've never had a problem. Okay, do you know what the problem is? Okay. This is a conspiracy, folks. Not a good sign. I've never had this problem in my life.
Where did they give you?
I can't hear you. Can't do it. Keynote. Come up here. Come up here. Okay, present the displays.
Yeah. So you don't turn the display, right?
I've got that clip.
Display, but you have to turn, so you have to go back to where you were with mirroring. So turn the mirroring off again. Yeah, so go back to there.
I've never had this problem in my life.
Yeah, sometimes it just messes up. I've had the same problem, right? So where are we?
Arrangement.
Yeah, turn off mirroring.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not mirrored. Right, and make sure this one's set to you. This one should be now right, 800 by 600.
Yeah,
that's fine. So can you close this now? So I'll go back to your main display. This one is fine. Just go. You can close that.
Okay.
Right now, no, if you start it up and it's not the right way around, just change that checkbox.
Just wait.
And it should be okay.
Okay, it's
now,
not.
Now flip it around, right? So go back to that setting again. That one you just had.
Do you actually know what you're talking about?
I've had this one before. Uncheck that box. Right. And then now do it again. No. Did it not uncheck the box for you?
Yes, it did uncheck the box.
Yeah. Now it's I've been screwed with exactly the same.
All right. Problem. Do you actually know what you're talking about?
I just wanted to make sure. Well, I'm just saying like the.
Okay, mirroring displays is always.
That sometimes fucks it up.
This is insane.
Okay.
I'm using Keynote, and I've never, listen, I've given presentations.
I know.
All right, we're gonna do this my way. I've got it as a PDF, but that's insane. Everybody has come over and said, take off mirror and put on mirror and change this, change that. I've been doing this for years, and I have literally never had a problem, ever. I mean, do you have some weird setup on your computer?
No. Definitely not something like the projector. Nothing in the projector and we can compensate.
Okay, let's see what we can do here. This is, I can tell you, the wrong setup. Done that and put it back on, and done that and put it back on, but I'll do it your way. And what was the solution?
Well, the other guy had a problem that he couldn't get his laptop out of widescreen. He was off right before.
All right, that's because the guy told me, quite incorrectly, to take off that. All right, look, we're going to have to do it like this. I mean, I'm getting the screen. Okay, just hold on one second. I mean, we're just going to have to do it like this. Okay, that's not going to work. Son of a bitch. No, just wait a second. just give me one second here. You're saying select the other one? Okay. Ah. Not even. Excuse me? If you can tell me what you want to do, I'll do it. Funny. Over where? There is no other. Okay. Am I supposed to know what you're talking about? You want me to select that? Okay, I did that 2 seconds ago. You want me to arrange it like that, correct? Are you looking over here, please? You want me to arrange it like that, correct? Where do you want it? Yeah, and what would you like me to do? Click on what? What do you want me to do? Yes, and what would you like me to do? And click on what? Yeah, your suggestion did not work. Huh? Okay, so can somebody put the projector settings on normal? Okay, so let me ask you something. The bottom line is...
Check. Yeah, I got audio. We should be good. Check. Audio, 1, 2, 3.
Okay, I have no way to run keyboard on that.
Oh, we got Steve Rambam, a private investigator, who had some run-ins with the law over the years, and basically he's won every one of them. Wow.
Okay,
check,
I'm
1, 2.
Undo every
check.
Thing that you guys told me to do.
Check.
What?
Check.
Check.
Audio. Check.
That's exactly what I did, pal. Now we need to set the resolution.
Oh.
What's the suggestion, Stefan? Okay, go sit down. Go sit down. Drag wide open. Okay, sit down, Stefan. Stefan, sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Do what? Yeah, hold on. Let me change the display. I think we got it. Okay, tell me what you want me to do, because I'm so sure you're wrong. Okay, it's 1024 by 768. You know what? It's not going to go full screen. Is this good enough? It's not going full screen.
How many hackers does it take to screw in a projector? Anyway, we got to get one. And I think, Steve Rambam, you could probably count on a couple of fingers all the Hope speakers who have spoken at every single Hope since 1994. 20 years, we go back with Steve Rambam. He's not only a legend in his own mind, he's a legend to all of us. And it's always guaranteed to be a jaw-dropping session of all the info, all the docs on you that are dropped by corporations. This is just private sector stuff. Government stuff would really blow you away. But in any case, Steve's going to give you a little less than 3 hours of jaw-dropping entertainment and fear-mongering.
Tinfoil hat wearing.
It's incredibly detailed. I saw some of the slides earlier. So I don't really have to give any more introductions, Steve Rambam. Oh, by the way, you want to mention during your talk the world premiere of your TV series just came out? So he'll mention that. It was next door a few hours ago. Give us a great presentation. Thanks. Steve Rambam.
Okay, so if I was going to have to do this like a... I'm telling you, this is, I'm cursed. It really is. Okay, what do I need to do here? Now I need I think I've broken. Okay. By the end of the day, every bit of hardware will be damaged. All right. Yes, my name is Steve Rambam, and this was going to be an extremely rapid talk because for the first time in a couple of hopes, I wanted to actually leave enough time for Q&A. Now I'm going to have to do this like a speed freak. I've been giving this talk for 18 years. 20 years ago, I was on a panel that covered this topic. 18 years ago, I started with the Privacy is Dead talks. This is my eighth or ninth Privacy is Dead talk. And privacy is now beyond dead. It's a little sad to me that it took an Edward Snowden to make everyone realize that every bit of their life, their digital life, their details of their friends, their family, their likes, their dislikes, where they go, what they do, what books they read, who they associate with, what their politics are, has drip by drip by drip been gathered into databases. I've been speaking about this for some time, but I think Edward Snowden has managed to provide much more graphic examples than I have. I used to point out that with any one piece of information, it's now possible to expand that one piece of information, whether it's a license plate, a telephone number. Today, just taking a picture of your face is enough. And it can be expanded to your name, your address, your phone, your date of birth, your social security number. There is no person in this room, from the United States person in this room, who I can't gather this information on them within less than 90 seconds. And if you don't believe me, come to me after the talk and I'll show you. I really will. Not just the basic information, how they vote, what religion they follow, what their politics are, but their medical history, what books they read, what music they listen to, what they do for a living, their skills, their salary, their employment, lawsuits, criminal prosecution, everything you've purchased, everywhere you've gone, and more than that, thanks to something called predictive profiling, where you're going to be next week and what you're probably going to be doing. The reason for this is self-contributed data. It's not the NSA gathering up your metadata, which, by the way, in the great scheme of things, is a joke compared to what's out there on you. This is not because the CIA or Big Brother. This is because everything that you do, you talk about, you tweet about, you post, you Facebook, every iota of your life you put out there. Now, I have to tell you, as a fellow citizen, it creeps me out. I'm a little older than most of the people in this room, except for the senior citizens in the front row. But you're here because your eyesight is bad and you want to see the screen. But except, for the most part, I'm a generation older than most of the people in this room. When I was, I feel like I should say something like, when I was hacking, I had to walk 5 miles in the snow with an acoustic coupler to find a payphone. The truth is, when I was your age, you didn't share this sort of stuff. There was an expression when I was a kid, damn, I wouldn't have told that. Now there's nothing that fits within that description. People talk about their sexual activities and their drug use and the crimes. I can tell you when I do an investigation, a criminal investigation, the first thing I do is I go to Facebook. You would be amazed how many people pose with the proceeds of their crimes or put up videos of rapes they've committed. It's not funny if you're the rape victim, so don't laugh. People share everything. I don't get it. As an investigator, thank you very much. But as a fellow citizen, as a friend, as a colleague, it creeps me out. Deviant, by the way, that's one of the great benefits of speaking at Hope. You hear from guys named Deviant. Deviant sent me a great example. Last week, there was an article in Wired magazine talking about new interfaces to the IMAP email system. I mean, the most boring article you've ever read in your life.
But apparently some people got very excised over it and had a troll fight. And one guy did what you should never, there's two things you should never say on the internet, Nazi or Luddite. And they called this poor schmuck who unfortunately for him had the name You Don't Know Me, called somebody a Luddite. Well, apparently he did know him. Your name is so-and-so and you live in Portland, Oregon. You're pretty shit at triathlons, and last year you humiliated yourself by coming in whatever out of 183. I'm sure your mom, so-and-so, wouldn't be proud to talk about it in her weekly gossip circles. She prefers to think about the days when she lived in Glendale or Pasadena. Instead of wasting time on a short-sighted son, at least you managed to trick so-and-so into marrying you, eh? By the way, she should update her blog such and such a URL. And it goes on like that for pages. For pages. And he ends. So the next time somebody talks about the importance of privacy, you should probably listen, imagine what people can find on you, blah, 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 and then one last zing, you know, his stupid cowboy costume. Listen, this is a guy with no special skills. He got insulted, it was a troll versus troll fight, and that's it. His whole life was on the internet. It's really this easy. And if it's this easy for a guy in the middle of the night commenting on a Wired article, imagine what I can get on you. People don't care. People put everything on the internet. You know what? By the way, the guy over here, for those of you who are lawyers, this is a drunken lawyer in a rabbit suit. Which to me, anything that gives me the opportunity to say drunken lawyer in a rabbit suit, great. People share everything. I just made love. This is a thing. This is an app. And by the way, here's the locations. And but I have to tell you, if you zoom in, half of these locations are parking lots. Seriously, try it out. Okay, I saved the sickest one for last. PMS buddy. This is a thing. You know, you want to warn your friends, don't talk to me for the next 5 to 7 days. But here's the sickest thing. Is my pointer working? Okay, well, I need one of those like green helicopter knocking ones, but okay, if you look over there, PMS buddy, now on Facebook. The little seal there. Great, so people look in, you know, they look at your Facebook page, they want to send you a note, oh, I better wait a few days. Okay. Now, I hope I made my point. Hey, thank you, brother. Okay. Jesus, this is like an... This is going to burn a hole through the screen. Okay. Thank you. I'm actually going to use this thing. Okay. Now to be serious. Why should you give a shit? Okay? This is no longer a G-rated DVD. Why should you give a shit? Here's why you should give a shit. Because you never can tell what's waiting around the corner in your life. And I say that as a guy who is probably the only one in this room to have been removed from a Hope conference in handcuffs. Look, in the 1930s, people who were left-wing, communist, anti-Hitler people were the good guys. In the 1950s, the same people were put in jail for what they did in the 1930s. There's a book I recommend that you read called Three Felonies a Day. I rarely give shout-outs to books, but it's an amazing book. It talks about how everybody in this country inadvertently commits three prosecutable crimes a day. It's really true. You can't, maybe not three, but one a week is enough. I can tell you that if I, as an investigator, target you, I will find something you can be arrested for within a couple of weeks of looking. Changed attitudes about dissent. When I was growing up, people understood that you're allowed to make a mistake. You get a reboot in your life. If you're a teenager, it's your job to screw up. It's your job to do something stupid. There's no sense of humor anymore. I can tell you that the U.S. Department of Justice is not about prosecuting bad guys, arresting bad guys anymore. And it pains me to say this as their colleague. It's about winning and losing. Once you are brought to the Department of Justice and arrested, it's all about making you plead guilty. 98.5% of all people arrested and prosecuted by the federal justice system in this country plead guilty. 98.5%. I can promise you 98.5% are not in fact guilty. The minute you go into, there's a saying in federal law enforcement, you can beat the charge, maybe, you can beat the charge, you can't beat the ride. And what they do to you is from the very first moment, they begin to destroy you. They confiscate all your money as proceeds of a criminal enterprise. So you can't afford an attorney, you can't afford an expert, you can't afford me. You can't afford bail. You sit in jail. You can't assist with your defense. As far as assisting with your defense, they don't give you the evidence until a nanosecond before the trial. And they give you an offer that is so widely disparate on how much time you might spend in jail. If you plead guilty, you get 18 months, you get your money back. If you don't plead guilty, in the case of Aaron Schwartz, 35 years. Plead to something, maybe you get probation or go to jail. Let me tell you, it is bullying of the worst order. And I want to tell you what was done to Aaron Schwartz, and he and I had a lot of mutual friends, one of whom I'm sure is in this room. I haven't seen her today, but she knows who she is. What they did to Aaron Schwartz was drive him to suicide. They did the equivalent of kicking a little harmless puppy because he was barking too loud. What did this kid do? He went into a broom closet with a bicycle helmet over his face. That's the best he could do to be a master criminal. And he was facing 35 years in jail because he had the temerity to hire an attorney and spend the money that he made and fight. If you fight, they don't care if you're innocent at that point. They have to crush you. They have to make an example out of you. And as I always am willing to point out, I'm a right-wing guy. I'm a very right-wing guy. I'm a very pro-law enforcement guy. I work with federal law enforcement all the time, not the FBI, but with pretty much every other agency, and most of them are great guys, most of them. I don't agree with a lot of what Mr. Snowden said earlier today, but he's right about one thing. The culture in this country has changed for the worse. He's absolutely right about that. And assuming that you're a good guy and you're a good girl and you're doing things for the right reasons and you think you haven't committed a crime, it's not good enough anymore. You cannot allow yourself to be put in a position where you can be made a victim for no good reason. You have the Obama White House asking for details of people who opposed its policies. You have Operation Choke Point, which I'm going to tell you about in a second. Next slide. Most of all, storage is damn near free now. And I can tell you that every governmental agency saves everything. And every governmental agency hoovers up everything. I do it as an investigator. Once you put a piece of information out there, it's not yours, you don't own it anymore, and you can't get it back. You can't. You can't change your mind. You can't say, you know what, I changed my mind. I want privacy. I want anonymity. And we're going to be talking about how difficult it is to be anonymous and to be an anonymous whistleblower. It's a real job. 1939, this was a Stop Hitler rally. This photo was taken by the NYPD Red Squad. This photo was used to go after the people in the rally 15 years later. What you do today might bite you in the ass 15 years from now. Operation Choke Point is the best example I could come up with. Do me a favor. Here's your homework assignment for tonight from Professor Steve. After this talk, go and learn everything you can about Operation Choke Point. This is not black helicopter stuff. This is from the Washington Post. The Obama administration has been pressuring banks to shut down financial services for absolutely legal industries that it disagrees with, to cut off the oxygen to these industries, hence Operation Choke Point. The ability to destroy legal industries through secret actions to deprive them of banking services has obvious political consequences. You think? Here's some examples. Ammo sales, coin dealers, dating services, escort services. All right, look, escort services isn't the most savory service, but it's legal. And they are shutting off services to legal industries that they disagree with. Huh? Whatever. Lottery sales, pharmaceutical sales, pornography. Listen, racist material. Would I like to see racist material disappear? Sure. Not as much as I'd like to see freedom of speech remain intact. You don't like what somebody says? Ignore him, put your foot in his ass, but you don't ban him. This is the current state of things in America. And by the way, it can be as simple as somebody going, oops, except the federal government never says oops. They never say I'm sorry. Of the 300 complaints, the last 300 complaints filed against FBI agents with the OPR, their internal affairs unit, not one was upheld. Not one was upheld. According to the Department of Justice, FBI agents don't make mistakes. That's a real thing. FBI checks wrong box, places student on no-fly list. Now, by the way, if you know about this case, it took 7 years of litigation for this poor girl to find out about this. And the witnesses that she was going to bring in for the trial were put on no-fly list the week before so they couldn't come in. Yeah, it's funny, you know, witness in a no-fly trial, put on a no-fly list. It's not so funny. It's not so funny. This is a new country. This is a new way of doing things. Dissent, inconveniencing governmental agencies is not tolerated anymore. And you need to start thinking about your information and your lives differently. This is not a happy talk we're going to be having today. So, you want to be an informant. To be an informant, you have to A, have information, B, deliver the information. And by the way, I'm going to stop saying informant, I'm going to start saying whistleblower. In my world, it's informant. In your world, it's whistleblower. So, how easy is it to figure out who a whistleblower is? Ridiculously easy. Ridiculously. Who has access to the information? That takes it down from 300 million people to 20. When was the information delivered? How do you deliver the information? How do you get the information and deliver it to the person you want to blow the whistle to? The Washington Post reporter, the WikiLeaks Dropbox, whoever. How do you do that? Follow-up questions. What happens if the reporter needs to get in touch with you? Hey, this is fascinating, but here's 87 things I don't understand. One reason why Snowden, who again I'm not a fan of, was so successful is he's interactive with the reporters. He sat down with them, he answered all the questions, you can reach him on the phone, you can video chat with him. Choke points. Choke points are where privacy invasion and government stifling of dissent meet. Choke points mean for me to get this secret information from point A to person B, I had to do one of a number of things. I had to call them. I had to email them. I had to go visit with them. I had to send them a letter. These are choke points. You can work backwards if you're a good governmental investigator. Now, I know what I'm talking about. I've done dozens of industrial espionage cases, which are essentially the same thing. Here are your problems. Cameras, drones, facial recognition, info capture. Cellular phones are the big paradigm changer. massive databases, nothing being thrown away. Profiling of persons, and the last is the most important. We're actually going to probably cut out about 100 of the slides so I can make sure that I'm talking to you about de-anonymization. You think that if you use Tor, and if you use a public Wi-Fi to connect to the Tor, and you use a clean laptop that you've scrubbed and you're only using for your whistleblowing, you can't be identified. Nothing could be further from the truth. There's now device fingerprinting. There's now forensic linguistics, which lets me identify who wrote something just by massive comparison of other posts to the net. There are dozens of ways that you can be de-anonymized. One critical point I'd like to make before we really start rolling. When I used to give this talk, I used to say, you know what? We're only going to talk about private databases, stuff that I have access to and other PIs have access to and a skilled hacker has access to. We're not going to talk about any of the governmental databases. Let me tell you why that's not a valid thing to say anymore, because there's no difference. The U.S. government today outsources its privacy invasion. Axiom, InfoUSA, all the three credit bureaus, Google, Facebook, especially Microsoft, including Skype, all provide information to the U.S. government. All. There is no difference. If you put something on Facebook, it's the same as you CCing it to the NSA. There is no difference. And one thing that Snowden talked about, which was important, anybody who doesn't share or who doesn't share quickly enough with the government says, no problem. They tap a cable, they write a script, and they suck it up. I can tell you that I have a computer in my office doing nothing, 24/7, 365, but grabbing Facebook pages, nothing. I have millions and millions and millions and probably tens of millions of photos in my office, and I'm going to show you some stuff. I guarantee you that the U.S. government has every single Facebook page, every single one with every single entry. And it's already been reported they tapped the cables right into Facebook, the data pipes right into Facebook and right into Google. Anything that you put up on the internet, there's no segregation anymore. There's no private information, public information. There was a case, USA versus Jones, where the Supreme Court quite correctly said, if you put a GPS device on a car, you've got to have a warrant. Can't do that anymore. FBI said, no problem. They just started going to the phone companies and getting the GPS devices off the phones, which is 100 times better. It's with you all the time. If you leave a car, you leave the GPS on the car. Nobody leaves their phone. 64% of people in America sleep next to their cell phone. 64% of those same 64% of people check their cell phone the first thing they do when they wake up. Maybe they scratch themselves, and then they check their cell phone. Nobody makes a secret about it. Here is Hold on, let me use the really good pointer. FedBizOps.gov, these are business opportunities. These are RPFs, requests for purchases, things that the United States government wants. This one, I mean, they announce what they're doing. They want to grab YouTube clips and video everywhere on the web and have interpretation of that, which I can tell you smart cameras can already do. People are fighting, people are driving, people are at a demonstration, people are giving an interview. You can now run a clip through analysis, and actually run millions of clips through analysis, and it will say, this is a clip with Bob Jones, and he's at a demonstration. Not a problem. All of the major companies have special governmental units for selling stuff to the governments. Here's, by the way, Google Government Services. Now, the funny thing is, by the way, there's an outfit called Pando. And when they put that up, Google immediately took down all the things they're doing for the government and just put up a generic page. They're still doing the same stuff. Facebook, let me tell you, Facebook is profiling and analyzing its members now in a way you can't even imagine, beyond what Big Brother dreamed. It's determining from postings and from content and from phrases your politics, your friends, your family, your associates, whether you're an activist or not, what you believe in, what you do. Here's keywords, parents to their adult children. These are keywords that they've determined indicate a parent to adult children relationship. Here's a parent to younger child. By the way, I had to emphasize that. One of the things is eye out. Like, if you keep running with that, you're gonna take your eye out. That's, I can testify that is something a parent says to a small child. And why are these companies, why is Google and Facebook and Microsoft and whatever doing this? One reason and one reason alone. They don't care about you. They don't want to know about you. Believe me, Zuckerberg is off, you know, slaughtering a chicken or whatever he's doing. He doesn't care. He wants to make money off of you. That's it. And the biggest possible customer is the U.S. government. And the U.S. government is right now not just gathering information, they're determining how to use it to influence people and to direct events, how to make a mob that's going left go right, how to make people support policies. It is the most insidious evil thing imaginable. And Facebook wants to get U.S. government contracts. So recently, they ran a test. If we put certain postings, if we take in the name of your friend and we send you a certain type of posting, will that make you do X? Will it make you do Y? And they tried it a million times. This news just came out very, very recently. Why is Facebook doing this? Because they want to make you happy? Because they want to make you sad? No, they want to give customers with a reason to use this the ability to influence people's emotions and actions. Facebook has a cell phone now. A cell phone is the biggest privacy invader there is. Facebook has a cell phone that can turn on the microphone, can listen to words, can determine what you're doing, what music you're playing, what TV. They say it's what music you're listening to, what TV show you're watching, so on and so forth. I don't care what the reason is. I really don't. This is outrageous. Facebook is profiling people in new ways. This is all new stuff. They are matching people. They are developing marketing that is the most finely targeted marketing imaginable. If I want a tap dancing Chinese grandmother in Milwaukee, they can give me 20 of them. It's amazing. Look-alike audiences. Facebook involves friending people and associating with people. Unless you are a remarkably open-minded person, which 99% of the world is not, you associate with people who are like you, who think like you, who like the things you like, who believe what you believe. If I don't know anything about you, and I see your 10 closest friends, I know everything about you. And that's a fact. You can send Facebook a list of numbers. They will tell you everything about the person at that number. Metadata? Metadata is child's play compared to what Facebook does. And I have to say, before we continue, I've always said one thing during these talks. I am not going to express a personal or a political opinion. I'm not going to tell you what I think you should think. I am going to tell you what I think you should think about. I'm going to modify that a little bit because things are serious today. And I want to say this. If you're horrified by NSA gathering your metadata, you should be insane. You should be marching with pitchforks and torches about what Google and Facebook is doing. Because number one, let's face it, they have less right and less need for it. I mean, the U.S. government, no matter what you say, is doing some good stuff. Like, fighting heroin importation, fighting Al-Qaeda. I mean, there must be something that the U.S. government does that makes you, that you will acknowledge, makes you safer, makes this a better, freer place. I mean, we can have this type of discussion. Trust me, if we wanted to go and meet with Mr. Snowden and have this conversation in Russia, not going to happen. Not going to happen. America's a unique, pretty wonderful place, in my opinion. A lot of room for improvement lately, but a pretty damn good country. And the U.S. government is using this information for that. I'm not being a shill for them. I'm just putting it out there. And I'm putting it out there to compare it. What the hell is Facebook doing with this? They're selling you T-shirts with cats' pictures on them. I mean, would you rather give out your personal information to be safe or to buy a T-shirt? It's a ridiculous example, but if you're upset about the U.S. government doing this, honestly, the one opinion I'll express today, you should be insane about Facebook and Google doing it. Amazon is the new repository for CIA data files. And at the same time, there's an Amazon phone, and if you look at what Amazon Fire TV does, it has a microphone. It listens. You cannot turn the microphone off. It sends your commands and your speech to the Amazon servers. Can't do anything about it. Nothing. And by the way, there's no off switch. There's no off switch. They learned something from the iPhone. You can't power it off that easily. Now I'm going to start speeding up. I just want to say that I give a two-day seminar on this general topic, which is called computer-aided investigation. What investigators and law enforcement and special agents need to know to use these tools. I'm giving you guys the Reader's Digest version of this, and I still can't fit in more than about 10%. And by the way, there's some stuff I wouldn't mention also, but never mind. Again, these are the key issues today. Cell phones, indexing videos, speech to text, cameras, efforts to create target marketing, but especially your data is worth money. Google and Facebook and Microsoft and everybody else out there will do whatever they can to get you to tweet and check in and blog and post and contribute as much of your life and as many of your photos and every other bit of data as you can. They will push you and urge you and tell you, hey, your friends posted 5 more photos. Why don't you tag these photos for us? It's worth money. It's always about money. Always. And there is no forgetting. Nothing. No data ever goes away. This is a slide I've put up every time I've spoken for the past 8 years. This is a guy who tweets every minute of his life. And you know what? It's not that unique. I look at some people that tweet 50 or 100 times a day. 50, I mean, there are people with 20,000 tweets. How is that possible? I mean, first of all, their thumbs, never mind. Facebook. 1 out of every 5 minutes you spend online, you spend on Facebook. 1 in 2 minutes on social sites on Facebook. People on Facebook are terrorized into using their real names, their ages, their email addresses, and to contribute, and it's never thrown away, never. And Facebook is colonizing the web. That's their term, not mine. Every time you click on a like button, every time you use your Facebook login to log in to make a comment or to log into another site, you contribute to the massive store of data that Facebook has, Open Graph. And Facebook has absolute contempt for you. Every time you push Facebook back a little bit, every time they take one step back in terms of privacy, believe me, while you're not looking, they do 2 steps forward. And it's not just actual subscribers. They are building shadow profiles of everyone who's not on Facebook, everyone who you reference in your posts, everyone through marketing databases they connect to you, or buying up the entire TransUnion credit bureau file they can connect to you. They know, even if your mom and your dad and your sister and your brother and your wife or your husband or whatever aren't on Facebook, they know who that person is. Everything. And by the way, your friends rat you out. This is a Facebook warning, which I guarantee you maybe 1% of even this room has seen. This is all the information that your friends contribute on you. If you don't put it out there, other people do. Facebook bought face.com. Probably at that time, the best facial recognition program in the world, and they've made it even better. And let me tell you why. And now I get to really use this green thing. I don't know, can you see this little tiny dark thing there? That's all the photos held by the U.S. Library of Congress. Okay, next one, Instagram. These are Instagram photos. Next, Flickr, and this is Facebook. There are, and this is an actual, so help me goodness, statistic, 1 billion photos uploaded to Facebook every week. 1 billion, I know I should do the little pinky thing, 1 billion photos, but it's not funny. 1 billion photos, all of which are tagged and identified and facially recognized, and add to this incredible store of intelligence agency level intelligence about you. People post everything. I don't know how many of you remember this. Guy duct taped his kid for talking back to him. And he posted it on Facebook. Now, by the way, of course, he got locked up. He lost custody of his kid. But what the hell? I have pictures I can show you of people who robbed a bank in South Carolina and put up on their Facebook page holding the money, a gun, and a bottle of liquor. You know, I'm gonna zip through a lot of this, but Facebook, both, and I know I'm gonna forget to mention this because I have speaker Alzheimer's today, but let me tell you, even if you don't make a posting, both Facebook and Google save your drafts. If you're just typing, even if you don't save the draft, if you delete it, it's still there. I want to tell you that I've seen law enforcement subpoenas executed on Facebook and on Google. And what was returned and the sources of it, some of it I'm not going to tell you. But I'm going to tell you that it is such critical information and such remarkable information that major law enforcement agencies today task an agent to do nothing but be their Facebook agent and their Google agent. Sit in the Facebook and Google headquarters and handle all the requests for information and expedite the really, really important ones. I can tell you, if you go and you pull up a thing on Google to start writing an email and you change your mind, even if you don't save it as a draft, you start typing and you say, nah, I'm not going to say that. It's saved. And there's a lot of examples like that. A lot of examples. Facebook is going to be a telephone company. Facebook announced its phone. Facebook is going to be successful at it because they have more money than God, and they understand that 85% of Facebook traffic today is on mobile devices. So they already know a lot about you. They get the information from your phone, but they want it to be their phone. And by the way, 87% uses Android. And I mean, this is during Zuckerberg's deposition, during the famous Winklevi litigation. This is what Zuckerberg said about his original Facebook. I don't know why they give me all this stuff. They trust me, dumb fucks. Let's talk about Google, and we're going to zip through this like mad. Google has enough storage space to keep every web page in RAM, in RAM. Google has 600 PhDs. Google uses more power than the entire city of Salt Lake City. At two points during the past 2 years, they had more ready cash on hand than the U.S. government. That's no fooling. No fooling. Google is not just search. Google is everything. Everything. Groups, Gmail, Google Voice, Android on 87% of the phones. If you use Chrome, if you use Google as an ISP, if you're in Kansas City, you have an unbelievable, wonderful, or Tulsa, or any one of the places where Google Fiber has been put in, you have an unbelievable connection. You have super whiz-bang fast connection for almost nothing. And Google views all your damn traffic. And this is what they want to do. They want to know everything that you do and everywhere you go and everything you look at and every interest you have. Not because they're big brother, because your eyeballs are worth money. They want to sell you stuff. And they're making billions and billions and billions of dollars. And they know on a regular basis your physical location. And they never throw that away. NSA metadata pisses you off? Nothing compared to Google. And frankly, nothing compared to Facebook or Twitter either, which I'm going to demonstrate. Every time you use an app, you download an app, you express an interest, it adds to their store of knowledge about you. You check for apartments in Brooklyn. You go to Yelp and find a Chinese restaurant. You search for an abortion clinic. You search for an address at 2 o'clock, and at 3 o'clock at that address, there's an Occupy Wall Street demonstration. They know everything there is to know about you, or it's only one step away from extrapolating to that. Everything, everything, everything. By the way, is anybody in here wearing Google glasses? Are you? Okay, somebody punch this guy in the face for me. I'm advocating violence, and I'm paying for violence. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. You know what? In today's environment, I you can't even make a joke. You can't even make a joke. I don't care if you have Google Glass. Google Glass, shut down. Did it work? Okay. Never mind. Google now has peer-to-peer monitoring of cell phones. If I don't know exactly where your cell phone is at, because the GPS-A didn't kick in, it's only GPS, and I can only tell within 1,000 feet, or 1,000 yards rather, no problem. I know you're right next to Bob's cell phone, and I know where Bob's cell phone is at. This is a patent filed by Google, using other cell phones to monitor other cell phones. I mean, it's a mesh setup, it's nothing unique, but it's being used for monitoring and data gathering now by Google. And tell the truth, is there a single person in this room who wouldn't be outraged, who wouldn't be throwing things if the NSA was doing this? But Google, yeah, we're cool with it. Hey, do no evil, right? We'll get to that. Everything. For those of you who used Goog 411, you know, find me, Hotel Pennsylvania. I'm sorry, did you say Transylvania? And finally, they made it perfect. And they did that for only one reason. Not because they love you. Not because they wanted to give you real, you know, free 411 and save you $1.95. It's because they wanted to use your input millions and millions and millions of times to perfect perfect speech to text so they could run conversations for the government and sell it. And that's exactly what they did. That's exactly what they did. I'm going to zip through this, but I'm going to tell you that Google uses every damn trick they can. They put out the best damn APIs. They want you to interact with their system because they get more information. They want you to design for them. They want you to use the Google URL shortener. Why? Because everybody who clicks on it, A, you've directed them to that, and B, They know what you're interested in because you've used that particular URL shortener. Google Glasses. Google patent filing would identify faces in YouTube. It's not news anymore. But if the NSA did this, you would freak. Google did it, you're cool with it. I don't get that. Google is a private industry. You have no control over their data. Once the information goes into Google, it is a private business record. In fact, the US government can track you 24/7 using telco information because it's private business records. They can't put a GPS on your car. But Google started with satellites, GOI, about 5 years ago. Google has now bought up a company, and they are going to have 50 satellites in orbit by 2017. Google will have more satellites in orbit than the entire United Kingdom. Okay. Everybody uses Google. I tell people there are two Rambam's laws. Rambam's law number one, you are what you Google. Everybody Googles their name. Everybody Googles their address. Everybody Googles their phone number. 31% of people, God knows why, Google their social security number. I have no idea why. Now I know y'all are gonna do it, and it'll go to 32%. People Google how to commit murders. People, a husband and wife arrested about 2 weeks ago because their son died in a hot car. The dad is in trouble because he Googled leaving a child in a hot car. These people, this little girl is dead. A couple of people strangled her. These two knuckleheads Googled how to strangle somebody. Everybody Googles everything. Let's talk about do no evil because I want to make my point. Google does whatever the hell it wants. It does not care about you. It does not like you. It wants money. It is an avaricious, rapacious machine of capitalism like has not existed since the coal and railroad companies of 100 years ago. Now, by the way, as an avaricious, rapacious capitalist, good for them. But it still sucks what they're doing to people. Street View. They had to be sued to take people's faces out of Street View. They actually fought it. Book scans and copyrights. You're a writer. You bleed for 3 years putting together a book. You copyright it. You put it out there. You're selling it. And Google, in violation of every copyright law in the world, just says, thank you, scans it and puts it up on Google Books. We're helping you. We're helping you. If people are looking for, the phrase vampire at midnight, we'll send them to your book. The head of the publishing industry had a great quote. He says it's like somebody breaking into your home and saying it's okay because he cleans your kitchen. That's not how it works. There's copyright. Misuse of trademarks. If I'm Pepsi Cola and I want to buy a trademark for Coca-Cola, if I outbid Coca-Cola, I get the ad word. Contempt. The all-mail folder, monitoring, Street View, going onto private roads, going into private businesses, scanning every copyrighted book, grabbing every news. Newspapers are dying. Newspapers are dying. And Google is one of the big reasons. You can go to Google News and read any article without buying the newspaper. Google Street View, by the way, let me zoom in on that for you. There you go. Apparently, it's okay if they take a photo. Data harvesting. They sent out Google Street View cars, sucking up passwords, sucking up Wi-Fi locations. Why? They need those damn Wi-Fi locations to position your phone if the GPS doesn't kick in. That's their version of Skyhook. Apple put a provision, a function in Safari where you could click do not track, where you could mess with cookies so you couldn't be tracked. Google said, I don't care. And they put a workaround into it. And 2 years later, they pay a $17 million fine. It's hilarious. They made $200 million getting this information from Apple users, and they paid a $17 million fine. Just a show of hands, I'm curious, because this was actually news to me until a year ago. How many people know what the all mail folder is? I love my hackers. About half the room. Any other audience, it would be like one guy. You delete mail in Google. You think it's deleted, right? Nope. They just move it to the all mail folder where it sits there forever. For those of you who didn't know about the all mail folder, open up Google, look at everything you think you deleted in the all mail folder. It's obnoxious. It's really, really obnoxious. Why does Google do this? Not because they really care about you or they want to invade your privacy or they want to be Big Brother. They want to sell you stuff. They want advertising revenue. And they suck you in with so many free services that after a while you have what's called in the investigative community Google addiction. You're not going to leave Gmail. Imagine you have to come up with a whole, you have to give all your email correspondence your new address. Google Voice, you have to give everybody your new phone number. Everything in Google Docs and in Google Drive and everything. It's a pain in the ass. You're never going to leave Google. It's a pain in the butt. And Google is very, very open. We can suggest what you should do next, what you care about. Imagine. We know where you are. We know what you like. A near-term future in which you don't forget anything because the computer remembers. If I look at enough of your messaging and your location and use artificial intelligence, we can predict where you're going to go. Show us 14 photos of yourself and we can identify who you are. You think we don't have 14, you think you don't have 14 photos of yourself on the internet? This is Eric Schmidt, Google's CEO. They're upfront about it. Hey, we're screwing you, but we're doing it because we like you. Everybody does the same thing. Amazon knows everything about your likes, your dislikes, your finances, and your actual physical address. Have you ever noticed if you're reading something on a Kindle, you stop at page 148, you reopen it on your iPhone, and you're at page 148? Magic, right? Wonderful. It's because they watch you read. And everything that you highlight in every major ebook reader, you're sending that highlighting to the mothership. Amazon, Apple ebooks, they know what you're interested in. Banking. Everybody's horrified that the U.S. government knows everything about your finances, that there's something called FinCEN that gathers all your financial data together. Horrible. Let me tell you, 75% of the identity checking and financial data gathering that the U.S. government uses is gathered by Equifax Banking Services, a credit bureau. And they sell this information. When I'm hired by a client, hey, find me somebody's bank account, the first thing I do is I pull an Equifax banking report on them. I see what banks check to see if Bob is really Bob. Probably Bob has a bank account there. Sometimes I even get Bob's safe deposit box there. Rambam's law number two. All data will eventually be used for unintended purposes. You may think you're putting something out there that's innocuous and unimportant. Wrong. It can be repurposed, and we're going to talk about that. I'll give you a perfect example. I track down fugitives and missing kids all the time using Domino's and Papa John's. You call Domino's, I know where you are. You had a pizza delivered there. You think you're on the run with your cell phone? I can't ping it because you turned it off? No problem. Sooner or later, you're going to order a pizza if you're under the age of 21. The holy grail, there's two holy grails for investigators and marketing companies. Your picture and where you are and what you do when you're there. And all of these things track. Microsoft, Apple Store, even Windows Media Player. Everything, if you use We, if you use a browser, I mean, every time that you log in, every time that you authenticate, and even when you don't, even We reports where you are and what you're doing. TiVo, TV, everything. You drive a car, Easy Pass, Sun Pass, OnStar. Most of the stuff you guys know, but you don't know that this all gets aggregated into larger databases of information. Unique serial numbers in everything. We're going to talk about this. Every single damn thing that you do digitally generates or is from something that has a unique serial number. GPS is now good enough that I can not only tell what corner you're on, what intersection, but which of the four corners in that intersection you're standing on, especially if you're in New York. Cell phones, and I'm sorry if I'm zipping through this, but we started late, and I want to end at 8 o'clock. I want to end the presentation at 8 o'clock and go to Q&A. And by the way, if anybody had any questions from the earlier event, which I thank you all very much for attending, you can ask questions on that too. Right now, everybody is migrating to cell phones. Facebook. As Facebook tilts to mobile, 575 million people around the world use the social network every goddamn day. 750 million people report their location, their exact location within meters to Facebook every day. Google services, 87% of the people who use Google. Guy's looking at his cell phone right now. I hope you're turning off location services. Amazon just introduced the cell phone the other day. This is the name of the game. And they're doing everything that they can do to hoover up your location every possible way. If you're in an urban area, they use Skyhook, they use Wi-Fi, they use P2P location. They use everything they possibly can to determine where you are 24/7. Why? Because they want to see what you're doing, what's of interest to you. If every Thursday you eat Chinese food for lunch, I guarantee you, within a year, you're going to be seeing things like you walk past your usual Chinese restaurant, you're about to go in, a coupon pops up on your screen. Hey, Julie, don't go into Big Wong's. One block down, there's Big Fung's. And here's a coupon for 50% off. Not because they really care that you eat Chinese, but they've got a deal with Big Fung's, and everybody who goes in and uses the coupon that they put on your phone, on your smartphone, they get a piece of the action. That's why they want to know. I want to tell you, and Bernie S., who introduced me, actually worked on this case with me, and a couple other people in this community, there was a 13-year-old girl who had been abducted by lured by a pedophile to Philadelphia, and we caught him, and she was on the run, and she ended up with another pedophile. We found her 1 o'clock yesterday. How did we find her? But here's how we found her, old school and new school. We knew she was on MeetMe. We did a connection to her on MeetMe and on Instagram. We saw when she was logging in. Law enforcement contacted me. Law enforcement has no idea what MeetMe is. Suffolk County Police Department. Great guys, but they're clueless with tech stuff. So we said, okay, here's their legal contact. Contact them, get us the IP addresses. We got back all kinds of crap. They couldn't trace the IP address. We went on a couple of public services that record every Wi-Fi address and where it is, every Wi-Fi IP address. We found their exact location in Media, Pennsylvania. It was the public theater there. We sent a bunch of guys out with wanted posters. Traffic cop, a meter maid, found her the next day, grabbed her. She broke away. There was a big chase. We had her in custody 1 o'clock yesterday. And we did it by tracking her IP address. NavTech is an example of what's possible. They log the GPS location of every business and every address. Every business and every address. If I know your GPS location, and I'm going to show you with T. Profit and some other people what I sneaky thing I did before the Hope Conference, they know, is there a parking lot, is there a bar? It's good enough to the point where GPS trackers put on people who are on parole for DUI will alert the parole officer if they go near a car rental agency or a bar. It's that good. It's that good. If you have a GPS in your car, you go find the nearest gas station, find the Chinese restaurant. That's how it's able to do it. They've got the GPS location of every single one. A cell phone will report to me your location history, who you hang out with, where you go. Do you go to a demonstration? Do you go to an abortion clinic? Do you go to a bookstore at 10 o'clock at night? Are you alone? Are you with somebody else? Are you getting on an airplane? Cell phones tell me every damn thing I need to know about you. As an investigator, if I have your cell phone stuff, I own you. You're owned. And I got to tell you, you're pissed off because the U.S. government has your location data. A, not such a big deal. I think everybody knew they had it anyway. And B, Google and Facebook have exponentially more connected to your cell phones. Here's tower location data. I know everywhere this guy is. Everywhere. P2P pinging. It's not just your cell phone connection. It's not just when your cell phone is telling a tower, hey, here I am, here I am. You're also broadcasting your Wi-Fi, and you're also broadcasting your Wi-Fi activity. There are now law enforcement and military and police programs that can target a geographic location. If I want, I can target the Hotel Pennsylvania, and I can identify every cell phone in this room. I can identify 95% of the people attending a Steve Rambam talk, no problem. I can identify 95% of the people that walk into a high crime location, a crack house. I can identify 95% of the people who attend a perfectly legal demonstration. This is social This is social networking activity. This is social networking activity. This is social networking activity. And by the way, once you have the people who are doing social networking on that location, you go to their social networking sites, their Twitter, their you can see what they're logging in through. Is it Twitter? Is it Facebook? Is it Google Plus? What the hell is it? And you can see exactly what they're doing and exactly what they're posting. Silly things like this. There's an actual case where Al-Qaeda got tweets with geodata and shot a mortar at the location because they knew that there were soldiers there that were bored and tweeting. That's an actual case. Don't believe me? Look it up. Here we go. And by the way, it's not just that. Just as a goof, we've developed a product for private investigators called GeoTwit that allows you to find, to put a guy's name in there and track him through through Twitter and track him through Facebook. I can get your location activity, and very often your pretty current location, without leaving my desk by backdoor pinging your phone through this sort of thing. I just put in, through Google's API, we just wrote a script, everybody who put in HopeX,